Hey guys, do you want a treat?
I have a brain. No, brain. Here's the brain. Yeah. Those brains are so tall, they get so complicated, so annoying to deal with.
They like cracking the wall.
Alcohol.
Alcohol. It's going to be useful, but you can make more. Chocolate and tampons. but if you don't have a working uterus, tampons will get you the moon. Bullets are difficult. I don't actually recommend them. Not as a trading supply anyway. You don't want to equip the people that might try to knock you down and take all your stuff with more ways to shoot you. I do recommend lipstick. Lipstick is an excellent trade good after the apocalypse. Water purification tabs. And a basic first aid kit. Now this may seem like a lot to put together when the dead start to walk. It kind of is. So I actually do highly recommend going home and putting this back together. The zombies may never come. We hope the zombies will never come. The zombies are already here. But these are all good and useful things to have under any emergency situation that disrupts local supply levels. Now, what is the difference between a short-term emergency and an actual disruption of your supply lines? Depends on what you want. I generally measure in Diet Dr. Pepper. Diet Dr. Pepper is shelf-stable for 90 days. If all the Diet Dr. Pepper in the world is expired, we're screwed. This is why the bit in Zombieland, to the popular zombie comedy that came out a couple years ago with one of the characters freaking out over the availability of Hostess products, is actually very realistic. Your specific needs, social situation, and lifestyle will determine what, for you, is the end of the world as you know it. I generally have 90 days worth of food in my house. I have 90 days worth of medication in my house. I have 90 days worth of cat food in my house, because let's face it, the priority is the cats. But when the Diet Dr. Pepper runs out, I know it's time to panic. Figure out what your one is and roll with it. We are, however, assuming that the dead have come, which they have. Can you bring me a zombie, please? We're getting it. These zombies cannot escape the sheer crowd because of reasons, but sometimes we'll let them out because it's fun. Come on, buddy. Don't eat the handler. Hi. Hi. This relic has forgotten he has elbows. That's good. Not all zombies will forget that they have elbows. So he's just going to push on this relic. Zombies don't get tired. The living do. Now the first thing you need to determine when you're dealing with a zombie apocalypse, because it is going to tell you what kind of trouble you have, is whether your dead people are living or dead. That may seem a little bit paradoxical, but we don't know whether this fella has a pulse or not. Now, it's difficult to get close enough to tell if a zombie has a pulse because there are some teeth up in there. And he's starting to remember that he's got elbows. No problem. Here we go. Hello. So, if you can check a zombie's pulse, do. If you can't check a zombie's pulse, what you want to look for are open wounds. What is the clotting factor? Now, are they actually bleeding freely? Or is everything sort of coagulated and gross? He really wants that brain, folks. He really wants it. Now, this makes no sense whatsoever, because brains are not the most delicious part of the human body. But zombies get a little fixated sometimes, so it's all good. It's all good. If you possibly can, while a zombie is distracted, get up in there and check the actual arterial pulse. A living zombie will still need to sleep. A living zombie will also still require water. This is great. A dehydrated zombie is not pursuing you very well. We're going to put this fellow back. Come on, buddy. Come on. Back in the corral. Aww. Now, our zombies are having a bad day. But they'll have a better day soon, I'm sure. Zombies generally do. So, it looks like our fella in blue is probably among the living. That's good for us. He will exhaust himself, given enough time, he will collapse, he will be unable to continue trying to eat us. The part where he is behaving like a classic movie zombie, that's bad for us. Because humans conquered this planet by being the best endurance predators the world has ever seen. We follow things to death. Even an injured human, even a human with limited walking capacity, is capable of following a horse until it drops dead. Endurance predation gave us this planet. And that is what is going to take it away from us again. Now, the problem with living zombies is that zombies have become that way because of a virus or some other disease. There are various things that can cause it, but what it is really something you want to know as quickly as possible. Is it airborne? Can you catch it by breathing it? Do you have it already? Is the world doing it? Is it something that's transmitted purely via bite, saliva? Are we dealing with a strain of rabies? Rabies is great. And rabies has never gone airborne. Airborne rabies is the end of the world. Now, our fella's back up. That's good. This guy's got a pretty good grasp on that arm. I'm sorry. He looks happy with that. This is a zombie that has retained some manual dexterity. So we don't want to mess with him too much at this stage. The zombie that can actually still use its hands is a big, big problem. So you also want to kind of observe zombie behavior as much as possible from inside your safe, secure little bunker. If your zombies still have hands, don't show them where the doors are. It's not a good plan. You cannot outlast an actually deceased zombie. You cannot outwait. They will just keep coming and coming and coming until they become skeletons, which is an entirely different and somewhat less disgusting problem. If your zombies are dead, however, I do recommend that you start breeding maggots. It's relatively easy to culture your own maggots in the kitchen. You'll probably have some rotten meat in short order because, well, the power is out at this point. Just set it out and get yourself a nice, writhing bucket of buddies. Now, once your bucket of buddies is ready to go, you can dump it over the zombies that are trying to come onto your property, and they will develop a whole new problem. Many zombies do not actually use human senses as we understand them. Triangles. For example, this fellow, he's still on the living. He does track with his eyes. So he's aware of motion. And if I stuck my hand past the chair line, I would have a problem. Walk around. I'm pretty sure this was done. And yeah, she is triangulating humanly by scent and by the strange awareness that zombies have of the living. There's no eye tracking going on. That's great. That means that if I am capable of dimming both my scent and the heat put off by my body, which can be done with various forms of camouflage, I can move through a swarm of this type of zombie with relatively little danger to myself. There are people who will tell you that the best way to do this is to root around in the guts of a zombie that you happen to find conveniently squashed by the side of the road. This is a really bad idea, folks. The human body is disgusting. Even those of us that are still among the living are technically made up more of bacteria than we are of human meat. We contain so many little organisms, and they are just waiting for the opportunity to have a party in our corpses. So does anyone have any questions about our zombies at this point? Yes?
Can zombies paradise now?
Some zombies can. Again, every zombie is different, which is part of why surviving the apocalypse depends, at least in part, on figuring out what you are dealing with. One of the more recent additions to our party is the cordyceps zombie. That's a fungal zombie that's been infected by a big fungus, basically, that takes over the brain and turns it into a driving fungus car. Those zombies tend to triangulate almost entirely. Why? You don't really know, but it might have something to do with the mushrooms where their eyes are supposed to be. Living zombies, again, like our gentleman in the scrubs, they can almost always triangulate. And because they tend to have a small vestige of memory that they were once just like us, hanging out in their brains, they will respond to words, but not in a way that you'll like. Now, some zombies can be soothed by certain sounds, sounds that they knew when they were among the living. There have been reports of a mother singing a lullaby to her zombie child and the child becoming less aggressive, or in one case, a group of heavy metal fans attempting to eat Led Zeppelin and being turned off with guitars. So there are opportunities. The thing about these exceptions, though, is don't ever count on them. If you are in a corner, if you are desperate, do whatever you got to do. You can't get out, so you might as well just start singing Green Sleeves and see if maybe the Renaissance Fair zombies will stop trying to eat your ass. But it is better if you don't wind up in that situation in the first place. So, here in my Warren or White Horse. The typical American home is apparently shaped like a box, because that's what I'm equipped to draw right now. We'll have your garage off to the side, yard. One door, various located windows. When the dead rise, what is the first thing you should do? Board up the windows. You want to secure those windows as tightly as possible. Now the fact that you have come here tells me that you have a vested interest in surviving if the dead rise, or that you were really, really bored this morning and thought this sounded like more fun than watching paint dry. So, if you check in your local area, there's probably a Home Depot or other such store where a gentleman that has been doing this since the dawn of time would be ecstatic to walk you through the process of boarding up a window. People think that it's as simple as nail a couple sheets of plywood up and call it good. It is not. The zombies will be in your house in 5 minutes, and you just cut off all visibility to the outside. So, take some time to a do-it-yourself class on apocalypse preparedness. Find someone who has actually built a house and is willing to tell you, hey, here's how you do it. Yes?
On an episode of Hustlers, they actually
boarded
up with part of the amount that people played.
Did they succeed?
They actually did.
So, things to consider, you know, when talking about the Mythbusters zombie episodes, anyone that's busting myths about zombies or anything like what we're doing right now, zombies lose manual dexterity compared to humans. So, even our fella that still knows what his hands are for probably couldn't do a cross stitch. However, they also lose the ability to really register pain. There are a lot of things that those of us in this room cannot do right now because our bodies will start saying, excuse me, and we will back off. But as we have all seen the reports of the mother who lifted a car off her child or something of that sort, zombies are in that state all the time, which is why it's important that we have this magical chair corral that they cannot cross for those reasons. Borrow your cookie sandwich.
Yes.
Well, he's managed to fight his way into having two limbs. There we go. Now, note that he's got the thing. He's got a pretty good grasp on it. I can't pull him out of the chair line because reasons. But I've got two hands, and he's fighting me off pretty easily with one. Really understand his own limits anymore. I will pull his arm off before I convince him to break this grasp if he doesn't want to.
But
shiny. There we go. Thank you very much. So the Mythbusters episode was actually a great example of how to board things up. My friend Meg was on that, but it doesn't address the part where a zombie that really wants to get in is going to rip their own hands off to get the board off the wall. So it is important to board the windows, but know what you're doing. It is also important to secure your door. Now you need the door, both front and back, and into the garage, to be at least partially usable by you. And doors are generally built more sturdily than windows are because, well, they assume that you might try to use them to get into your house. But you're going to want to keep those as secure as possible, and I actually do recommend boarding up and annihilating your front door. You can even write helpful things on your front door, like, everyone inside is dead. Have fled for Cleveland. Do not open live bees. And this is because as the zombie apocalypse wears on, your greatest danger will actually come from other survivors. Other survivors are going to want the things that you have. They're going to want your food, they're going to want your water, they're going to want your go bags. In some cases, they're just going to want your you. And this is a concern. So the more you can make your house look like it has fallen to the zombie horde, the better off you are. So those of us that have put off repainting for the last 10 years, hey, we are a step ahead of things. Now, assuming you do have a garage, remember, it's not just for storing Christmas decorations. It's also for storing provisions. If you have any local Mormon friends, talk to them. Part of the Mormon religion involves keeping a year's worth of food on hand at all times. And because that is generally viewed as a human service rather than a religious thing, Most Mormons will be happy to talk to you about how to organize your pantry, how to make sure that you can keep those provisions on hand. If you live in a city, the average American has access to 3 days worth of food at any given time. That's not so great when supply chains fall. So, if you can set up provisions in your home, you're doing really well. You're still not hitting the point of having an underground bug out bunker, so you don't have to worry that your mom's going to tell your grandma that something's wrong with you. So our types of zombie are virus. This is a great risk right now because we've cut CDC funding by 30%. Yay!
Can you, Trump?
Did one of the zombies just speak?
Oh, no, it was that one.
That's good. Viruses come in multiple strains. The ones you really need to worry about are airborne and bloodborne. Not just a video game anymore, folks. Airborne is a much bigger concern. Airborne viruses we've all caught already. Bloodborne, if you can avoid immediate contact with the living dead, you're probably okay. Assume that any disease not transmitted via air can be transmitted via all bodily fluids. This is probably incorrect. Odds are good that if a zombie sneezes on you, you will not become a zombie due to snot. But better to be safe than sorry. Prions. A prion is a misfolded protein particle, generally found in beef. If you have spent 6 months cumulatively in the United Kingdom over the last 15 years, you cannot give blood because of the chance that prions are already inside you. They cause mad cow disease. An accelerated prion could effectively cause the zombie apocalypse. The nice thing about prions is that despite what movies like Zombieland will try to tell you, they are not actually tractable via bite or other food. So if a bad batch of bee triggers a zombie apocalypse, it will be limited, it will have trouble replicating itself. It'll probably be fine as long as we don't get eaten. Or eat the zombies. Do not eat zombies. Nanotech gone wrong. Why does people bother with nanotech when it always goes wrong? Because it looks cool. Nanotech gone wrong is functionally the same as an airborne virus. All got it, try to avoid triggering whatever it is that just turns your neighbor into a flesh-eating loon. Fungus. When fun dust comes to the party, none of us has a good time. The two best examples of the fungus zombie at this point are the video game The Last of Us and the book The Girl with All the Gifts. Relatively rare, still going to be a problem, functionally the same as the bloodborne virus. Direct contamination, but you're probably in a lot of trouble. Aliens. And if it's aliens, I'm mad at them. They could have done something so much better than zombies. Why didn't you bring back the dinosaurs, aliens? Why didn't you just come down in your tripod sticks, or your tripod ships, and eat us all? We don't know. Why did we just not throw our pins on the floor? Come back, you. I am very physically adept and will easily survive a zombie apocalypse. We don't look grabby chance for the arm here. On the arm. He's a little too aware of himself. I want a zombie to take her out a little bit. Because she is clearly among the dead. Zombie. We do like as a shambler every now and then. So shambler is always having a good time by herself. Come on, honey. Yeah. Also, she doesn't have a lot of throat damage. Human physiology presents certain limitations even for the living dead. They are bound by the outline of their own skeleton. Okay. So, as we take a look at her, the best, yes, honey. And she also doesn't realize she has a pulse, which is always nice. That's good. So, rigor is our friend. Because people do tend to walk with their arms down, which is why you get that very classic arms outstretched zombie posture. At a certain point, they lose the ability to bend their elbows completely. Now, this will come back. We like to forget that there is a stage after rigor. She'll probably hit that 2 or 3 days, so we're good for her for demonstration purposes right now. Now, on a human. If you wanted to stop a human attacker, you could do a lot of things. You could stomp on the instep, you could do a kick to the groin, you could even just disembowel them if you're a real jerk. None of these things are going to slow her down very much. She'll just get intestines all over my shoes and, you know, continue to be hungry. In this case, with a zombie, what you want to do is separate the head from the body in as effective a manner as possible, or blow as much of the brain out the back of the head as possible. If you do not have a gun, and you have already established that you are dealing with a blood-borne zombie, you can generally do some good things with machetes, scythes, and other farming implements. You're in farm country, people. Work with it. You can also, if you have a horse, loop a rope around the zombie's neck, tie the other end to your horse, and go for a drag. This will work relatively well at separating the spinal column, but it will make a mess. Now, we can see she really wants to get over here. She's hungry. She's always hungry. That's understandable. But she doesn't understand what I'm saying. So we could full-on plot her death right now. And she would not be able to react. Distraction is important with the dead. My main goal is keeping her elbows from bending. So we're just sort of waltzing here. Now, if you are forced to get in closer, your goal now becomes keeping those teeth away from you. If you can get a hand under the zombie's chin, you're generally going to be pretty safe. It's okay, honey. It's okay. So, note again, no real visual acuity. She doesn't track well. If you can get a hand in here, you'll be able to keep yourself from getting bit. Now, this is a very controlled environment. I have multiple handlers with nets. I have zombies that have been selected for their relative freshness. Rigor comes in at about 2 days. We can lock their joints. That's helpful. You don't want to dance with a zombie in the wild. That's a bad plan. That's a good way to wind up dead. I'm going to return her to her handler. She's looking a little tired now. You do try to follow ethical zombie handling rules here, much as you do at a bird flight show at the zoo. It is important not to exhaust your zombies. An exhausted zombie is an unpredictable zombie. An unpredictable zombie is eating someone. They do not like the cheer line. Do you have any other questions right now about our zombie assortment or our plan thus far? No?
What about fast zombies?
So fast zombies! Fast zombies are almost always among the living. And this is because if a dead thing tries to run at the speed that the fast zombies are occasionally seen moving at, they will break down cartilage and lose the ability to move very quickly. Now I say almost always because honestly, it does not matter. If you are being chased by a fast zombie, you're being chased by a fast zombie. The fact that it's alive, dead, whatever, kind of behind the point. Now we do have one fast guy here. That was our fella in white. We saw him running a little earlier. So he can run when he feels the need to do so. That's also why we haven't brought him out yet. The chances of a containment breach when we break him out are much higher. And now a fast zombie usually is going to be infected by a strain of rabies or a modified strain of measles. That scientists really love working with measles, and I would really like them to stop. Measles is a disease that wants to be airborne. Being airborne is its primary goal in life. So making a non-airborne strain of measles in your lab is basically like saying, well, I put 17 hyperactive four-year-olds in the room where I keep the cake. It'll be fine. It's not going to be fine. Now, our fast boy here, because he does have reasonable manual dexterity, I'm assuming he's alive. I haven't checked his pulse because, again, fast. Not actually that into losing a hand today. If he is dead and he comes out, the odds are good that I can win if I can just outlast him for 16 hours. If he is alive and he comes at me, the odds are good that I can't win. I need to get up a tree, I need to get into a secure location, I need to get in a car as quickly as possible. And that's because, again, he does not understand his limitations anymore. Living or dead, he will run on a broken foot, he will run on a broken ankle, he will run on a shattered pelvis. There are various things that you can break that pain will stop you from using because your body understands that further use will destroy them, that technically you can push a little more out. And we do see reports of living uninfected humans doing that in war zones, in situations where really the adrenaline just kicks in and you ignore completely the limitations of your body. Fast zombies, again, they're a problem. We're not their biggest fan. Now there is the possibility of a cure with a fast zombie because it is presumed that they are living. However, amount of time they spend being fast, because they will pulverize their entire skeletal structure to get to you. You have to ask yourself, when viewing the possibility of cures for any type of zombies, would you want to be cured after you had eaten your entire family? What are the odds that people will attempt to hold zombies liable for crimes that they commit while under the infection? Is there any chance we can actually sue Monsanto for kicking off the zombie apocalypse? Because in that case, I'm curing everybody just for the testimonies. Now, assuming a viral zombie apocalypse, which is the most common, there are certain steps you can take to try to keep yourself a little safer. Once the zombies have come, you're gonna go ahead and select clothing that is comfortable, well-fitting, you can move in, and is made of sturdy materials. I cannot list the sheer number of times I have seen someone go, "This is my zombie hunting heroine, she's wonderful, she's gonna go out and fight the living dead, and she's gonna do it while wearing cut-off shorts and a bikini top, because she is an empowered woman." One, she is a fictional character at this stage. Fictional characters are bound to your choices. Their empowerment comes entirely from you. So please stop a moment and ask yourself why Daisy Dukes in the handkerchief top says empowered woman to you in a way that, I don't know, body armor doesn't. But two, if you go out in the zombie apocalypse like this, unless zombies are possessed of some kind of virological quirk that renders them unable to see naked people, you're going to die. This is how you end. I hope you had a lovely time, but I'm not going to save you. What you actually want at this point for dealing with the zombie apocalypse is pants. We like pants. Pants have pockets. Pockets can hold useful things. You want to keep them as well-fitting as possible. Cargo pants have way too much opportunity to be grabbed. But make sure that they are a fabric that your dog can't bite through. Good sturdy denim is actually a surprisingly good choice for the zombie apocalypse. In addition, if you're wearing denim and you have any friends that do SCA for fun, you can say, "Hey Bob, chainmail is great. Aluminum chain is not that heavy, and it prevents bite damage. It does not prevent crushing damage. You will come home with some astonishing bruises, but you will not have your arm bitten off." If this sounds unreasonable to you, I'm a herpetologist in my daily life, and I wear chainmail when I'm working with crocodiles. Never smile at a crocodile, folks. Never tip your hat and stop a shadow. Now, for the upper part of your body, because you're going to want some stuff there too, you're going to want a proper jacket. When I say proper jacket, I mean, again, look at zoologists, look at bite-proof materials, look at leather, look at denim, look at really sturdy khaki, look at things that you can move and breathe in that are suitable to the environment in which you're working. You know, heck, middle of summer is going to be a lot more difficult to wear multiple layers than middle of winter, but middle of winter you might be wearing clothes that actually mess with your movement capability. There's always a trade-off. This is the one time that I will say a chainmail bikini really is empowering. It's empowering for men and women alike, because again, it prevents bite damage. However, if you are a person who has hair on your chest, waxing is going to be a very big friend of yours, because no one likes it when the chainmail grabs hold. Ladies, cut your hair. Gentlemen, also cut your hair. You don't want to have something convenient for a dexterous zombie to grab onto. Even a non-dexterous zombie, if you have long hair that is loose, they have hands. Without the ability to grasp, they're not going to be able to grab and pull you back, but they will be able to get stuck in your hair. If they pull you to a halt, you're pretty much done. Now, assuming that you're going out in your lovely chainmail clothing and your lovely bite-proofed outfits, you are still going to have a few problems to deal with when you make it safely home, which is splash debris, fomites, and mucous membranes. Anybody know what a mucous membrane is? side of your ear and your genitals. Now, all of these are areas where the skin is porous and it can absorb things more quickly. This is part of why frequently when you're given medication that is not for direct swallowing, you'll be told to rub it under your tongue, rub it inside your ear. Rub it actually with some menthol bases, you'll rub them on the inside of your nose to try to get them to work faster and encourage skin absorption. This also means infections can be passed in this way. If you touch something that has had splash debris, a zombie has bled on it, or in the case of something that is airborne but difficult to contract, has been sneezed or breathed upon, and even fomites become it. If you touch that thing and then touch your eye, you can actually infect yourself. And your party thinks you're fine. This is not a good party gift. They will not enjoy it. No one will have a good time. Now, I have a mobile fellow here. He's got some damage on his face. That actually looks more like a rooster. Hey, buddy. Hi. Good. And they pass the chair lines. We're good there. And he can try pulling me in with him. Now, I don't see any actual bites on him. I'm not going to disrobe him. People were kinder to our test subjects than that. But it looks like he was probably infected through some kind of fluid transfer or a fomite base, which makes sense when you're dealing with fast zombies. Now that I've touched his hands, where shouldn't I touch myself? On my face, in my hair, really anywhere. Now, it is a fun fact. Humans touch our faces constantly. We're frequently unaware of it. This is part of how the flu spreads so quickly and so well. This is also part of why cruise ships, amusement parks, even some nicer restaurant chains have started putting hand sanitizer outside the bathroom. You still want to wash your hands as much as possible, but you're then touching the handle to the bathroom door. And all the hand washing in the world doesn't save you from the man who didn't wash his. So hand sanitizer is a good idea. Hand washing very thoroughly with warm, hot water is a good idea. When you do wash your hands, you want to continue for the length of a full recitation of Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, or the equally long children's song of your choice. I know that sounds a little silly, but this has been a brutal flu season, people, and we're looking at a brutal zombie season. So as long as you can put off your own infection, the better. Try to find some shelf-stable foods that you enjoy that you will take as a treat, and stock up on them. Stock up on them and set yourself some standards for how many you're allowed to have in the event of disruption of supply chains, whether it be the electrical lines or the rise of the living dead. You know, if you can just have a granola bar a day, you will stay calm and sane much, much longer. Looks like we're starting to have a few problems with our handlers over here. We do have about 9 more minutes to go. We'd like our handlers not to be devoured in that time. Please try. Yeah. All hail the chair line. No one knows why it works, but it sure does. Does anybody else have any questions about our dead people or zombie apocalypse survival in general? Yes?
What about the zombies who eventually came
up with the Night of the Living Dead is actually a really interesting example because those are meant to be dead people. They're dead zombies, but they gradually regain certain aspects of the living. This is highly unrealistic, says the person at the Zombie Survival Seminar. Mostly it's unrealistic because some of the things that we attribute to zombies, you actually can mimic with diseases that we know exist. You could potentially set up a rabies infection that behaved like those zombies, where people started out being extremely irrational and extremely violent, and then gradually regained enough of their sense of self without regaining the ability not to attack people around them, to start using guns, to start using other tools. Whether those are zombies or just sick people is rather heavily debated in horror circles. That is part of why it's important to watch the zombie behavior. I'm assuming you've all managed to survive the first wave, you're nice and walled up in your house, you've convinced all of the other survivors in town that you're not in there, you've got a whole lot of blueberry muffins from Costco, and you're riding this shit out. But you're still going to want to watch what the zombies are doing. You want to know where they're massing. You want to know if they're coming to your place. You want to know if someone is hurting them toward you, because that could be another survivor having recognized your presence. And if you start to see new behaviors on the part of your zombies, become alarmed. again, looking at our books here, we have one fast, we have one living, we have one dead. Now, those are big, broad categories, but we can make some basic assumptions about their capabilities from watching our little trio. He is currently capable of holding and grasping things. He knows he has opposable thumbs. He knows he can use them to oppose things. So, is he going to figure out tool use? It's entirely possible. As a fast zombie, it's very likely that he is still alive, because he is both fast and still moving. And he's not slamming himself in walls, so he's not in the earliest part of the infection. Now, our living zombie here, he hasn't figured out his thumbs yet, but he is very aware of sound. He's very aware of this is what a living person sounds like. But he has started making that fist gesture. Now, he was not doing that when we first brought him in here, so we could be seeing the virus starting to evolve a little bit. Will he actually grab me? No, he's not grabbing, he's just kind of pawing at him. Whereas this fella here, he will grab. See, that is a difference in evolutionary step. Now, are we looking at two zombies with the same disease, and this is an earlier infection? That's possible. You're going to want to watch for that kind of behavior. Our dead girl, we know what she does. Now, she might explode into spores at any moment. That's possible. She could be filled with parasitic alien worms that are just going to come spilling out of every orifice. Also possible. But that's not so much behavioral change as an infection change. They are going to eat a handler at some point. But that is why we buy them by the bucket. Sorry. Viral zombie apocalypse that kills you, because an asthmatic human will be an asthmatic zombie unless they are dead. Dead people don't breathe. If you are looking to change teams as quickly as possible, it has been documented that zombies spread the infection and then devour. So while later caught humans will still become zombies if enough of them is left, you are more likely to be bitten and then allowed to escape early in the outbreak. So if you want to become a zombie with as much of your body intact as possible, thus increasing the odds of getting your own war, as soon as you're sure that the dead are walking and that you really don't want to deal with running out of your inhaler during the middle of the apocalypse, you want to just quietly go outside, cover yourself in steak sauce.
Zombies actually have taste for steak sauce, or is that just...
It's a strong smell.
Okay.
Any strong smell will get them. You could also just not shower for a couple of days, which, let's face it, when the dead start walking, most of us will not shower for a couple of days. Because the shower is a small, tight space where you can't really hear what's going on. You're going to want to have somebody to watch the bathroom door while you're showering, because otherwise you're going to be that scene from Psycho.
You recommend baths or showers?
I would recommend showers, honestly. Baths are quieter, but baths take longer. It is more difficult to stand up. The odds of slipping and falling are much, much higher. So unless you're dealing with a situation where zombies cannot detect humans who are submerged in water. Yes? Buckets of water and
sponge baths.
Sponge baths! Honestly, I would recommend sponge baths at that stage. Got time for a couple more questions? Anything at all? Well, I do recommend figure out who your possible zombie apocalypse team is and just put it together ahead of time. I have my social group. We all know what skills we bring to the table. We all know what stages of the apocalypse they will become useful during. For example, I am not super great at running. I have a janked up foot. I am also, however, a graduate of the University of California, Berkeley, Go Bears, who's on the archery club for 5 years. And I am a remarkable shot with a longbow. So I'll just go sit on the roof and pick off zombies. Once we have any ability to scavenge, I am a remarkable scavenger. I not only know all of the edible plants in my area and how to distinguish wild carrots from wild hemlock, which is an important survival skill, but I am not afraid to eat basically anything. So I will come home with raccoons going, they're delicious once you cook them enough to get out the red worm! And that's really helpful when more squeamish people are on the hunt for. My friend Kate, on the other hand, is a shooter. She owns several firearms, knows how to use them, although keeping zombies off our door, and is a knitter. And knitting is going to be a very vital post-apocalypse skill. You want people that can do all sorts of things. I know folks that have put together their zombie survival team and it's just five or six linebackers with machetes. I'm like, that's cool. Great, fun time for you. How are you gonna eat? Do you actually know how to skin a rabbit? Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts are amazing. Can you start a fire? Can you boil beans? You want to try and assemble people with as many different skills as possible, and know going in that everyone is bringing something to the table. My friend Mandy is a wheelchair user. She is still part of our zombie apocalypse survival team. You will get people who are, quite frankly, ableist assholes, who will tell you that the best thing to do for your disabled or differently abled friends is to abandon them when the dead start to rise so that they can die as quickly as possible. Now, if that's your choice, you know, if you want to become a zombie leader rather than living with asthma when inhalers are hard to get, you can make that decision for yourself. But don't make that decision for your friends. Don't say, well, Mandy uses a wheelchair, so clearly she wouldn't want to live. You know what? Mandy wants to live, and she can go faster on a flat stretch of ground than I can, so she's just going to be wheelchair racing those zombies all the hell over Seattle. It'll be fine. But don't let yourself get into the mindset of thinking any person who comes to your group, who adds to your group, is a burden. No one is a burden. We're all just bringing different shit to the table. I'm looking forward to the zombie apocalypse, because then they'll stop putting mango in everything, and my biggest disability will no longer be an issue. Hey, do we have any other questions from the audience at all? Well, it depends on the number of zombies. For example, here we've got three. Very confused fellow there. Got three. We could probably take them out if we're all armed, and if they weren't research subjects. But you could also run, standing a chance of escaping. The big thing to remember, though, is that where there's one zombie, there's about 500. Zombies reproduce at a prodigious rate. They really don't care about you. When running from a zombie, you don't have to be faster than the zombie, you just have to be faster than the person in front of you. Now, he really likes Sam. He's having a good time. Hi, bud. Hi. I see you too. Good. Good. Is that two of you? Now, you can form a horde, even from unrelated zombie types. If you just get them all into the same thing, she's not so much sound responsive. She is smell responsive, and humans make the smell of human when we rub ourselves together. Okay, hey baby, see? And now we've got ourselves a small horde, and that's great fun. And my handlers are really equipped to run away, and that's great fun too. Because what we're going to do now is show you why this is a bad idea. Hey guys, run! Bye!
Migrant, a.k.a. Sean and McGuire, is also